Good morning, dear students. Let us start with leadership today. This is a topic which we would be covering. We would be covering theories of leadership, that is in three categories: trait theories, behavioral theories, and contingency theories. Let us start up with what do we understand by the term leadership. It is the ability to influence a group toward the achievement of a particular goal. So when we talk about leadership, it's more over goal achievement and achieving the targets with the help of the leader. There are certain theories of leadership which we would be covering. The first is the category of trait theories, under which we are going to cover Gisele's personal traits. Behavioral theories is the second category, where we would be covering Michigan studies, managerial grade, and the third one, the contingency or situational theories, Paul Hirsch and Blanchard theory, and the last one is goal setting theory or path goal theory. The first one is the trait theory. Now this theory of leadership believes that the leaders are basically because of their traits, because of the characteristics they have. So the trait theory of leadership focuses on the individual characteristics of successful leaders. Leaders possess a set of traits which make them distinct from followers. This is what is being focused in trait theories. That is, so there are certain characteristics or traits which a leader possesses which are very different and distinct from the followers. It rests on a traditional approach which describes leadership in terms of certain personal and special characteristics which are not acquired by knowledge and training but are considered inherited. So basically, this emphasizes on that leaders are born and not made. That is, this trait theory, it totally rests on one thing, that is, the leaders cannot be trained or they cannot have a professional education and thus become a leader. It totally believes that leaders are born and they have these inherited traits which distinguishes them from the followers. The first theory here is Gisele's personal traits. Now Gisele studied 300 managers from 90 different companies and his findings suggest that the following personality traits range from very important to unimportant in relationship to leadership success. So here are certain traits which are differentiated by Gisele, which actually he has given, which ranges from very important to unimportant, and the first category is very important traits. So based on the research wherein he had spoken to 300 managers and that too from different companies, he could identify and categorize these traits into these three categories. The first one is very important traits, that is decisiveness, the power to take decisions. So it's considered to be very important according to Gisele, that is leaders should have a power to take the rightly in a right time and a very good decision. Intellectual capacity, they need to have some cognitive ability. This is another trait which is considered to be very important by Gisele. They should have the capacity to think, to react, and then to take a decision. Job achievement orientation. They should have this thing that the followers should achieve their job. They should fulfill their work in the given time. Self-actualization feelings. That is, they should have the ability to accept challenging tasks and the tasks which give them a feeling of self-worth and self-confidence, not just trying to fulfill the basic requirements of the organization. Self-confidence, which is another very important trait, and team builder. So a leader needs to be a team builder wherein he would actually manage a big or a large team and achieve the goals. The second category of traits which are given is moderately important. Now these traits are they somewhat lie in between. They are not very important or not important at all. That in between they would lie. And this is affinity for working class. The leader should have that feeling of belongingness towards the working people, towards the employees, which is a very important trait, a moderately important trait. Drive and initiative, that is, they should have a feeling of coming ahead with new ideas and giving new changes in the organization. Need for a lot of money. Now, it's a trait which describes that a leader should actually have a need for money, that is, he needs to have somewhat the need or lust, not lust, but then, you know, he should have that much profit earning motive. Need for job security. So he needs to have a feeling of security, and also to give amongst employees a sense of security that they are secure in the organizations. So he has to provide this type of feeling to the employees. Personal maturity, he himself should be so matured that the employees should feel secure and should be able to share their views in a very open way with him. Now the third category given by Giselli is not important traits, wherein he says it is gender difference which is not at all important for being a leader. So whether it is a male or a female, it doesn't matter. The leader traits are which matters a lot and which are more important. The problem with Giselli's research is that several traits are interdependent and there is no indication of how much of any trait a person should have to be an effective leader. So there is no degree which is as such mentioned here which would describe that this is the degree of one particular trait which a leader should have, and it is only a description of how many traits or what various types of traits a leader should have. So let us go ahead with behavioral theories. Now this category of theories, actually they try to explain the leadership style. That is, leadership is determined not by characteristics, but it is by the leadership style or the behavior of the leaders towards the followers. And this is how the organization's effectiveness is determined. In this category, there are few studies like the Michigan studies. The first theory which we study here is the Michigan studies. It was given by Linkard, and he carried out a research to identify styles of leader behavior that resulted in increased work group performance and satisfaction. These studies resulted in the development of two different types of leadership styles. Now you can see here, the first is employee oriented and another is production oriented. The first one, employee oriented, is the it's more focused towards employees. So it is one type of leadership style which is wherein the leader is more focused over relationships over employees. So the first thing is emphasize interpersonal relations. So leader is more he's concentrating more on people aspect of the business. He takes a personal interest in needs of their employees. He emphasizes delegation of authority, wherein he tries to pass on somewhat his authority amongst the people so that they could themselves work independently. Employees need advancement and personal growth. So he also believes in one thing, and that is that employees do have a need of advancement and personal growth. The second leadership style as given under the Michigan studies is production oriented. This production oriented style, it focuses basically on the leader's emphasis on getting the task done and getting the production done in a timely way. Such leaders emphasize the technical or task aspects of the job. Main concern was accomplishing their group tasks. It used rules, procedures and close supervision of subordinates. So all these are the traits, or we can say the style of leaderships which are more emphasized upon production or getting the task done. Now as per this study, the leaders can vary on the scale or the degree of the style which is being followed. Some leaders might follow a mixed approach, or some leaders might lie into only one type of orientation. So the conclusion is of this theory is favor strongly the leaders who are employee oriented. and they lead to higher group productivity and higher job satisfaction. So as per these studies, they found out that it is the leaders who are more employee oriented who would result into higher group productivity and higher job satisfaction. The second category of theory in this behavioral studies is managerial grid. It was developed by Blake and Morton, and it is considered to be one of the famous studies wherein five styles of leadership were identified. Herein you could see that there are two dimensions. One is concern for production, another is concern for people. Again, it is somewhat like the same dimensions we have discussed in Michigan studies, that this concern for production would be more of production orientation, and concern for people would be more of employee orientation. Now with these two dimensions, he tried to identify five different types of leadership styles, where you can see the entire grid is divided into five coordinates, or we can say five numbers. Now wherein the first dimension is concern for production, it means the attitude of superiors towards quality of policy decisions, procedure and process, creativity of research, work efficiency and volume of output. These are the emphasis which are being laid down by this leader on when he has more concern for production. When a leader has a high degree of concern for people, he would be more committed towards goal achievement, maintaining the self-esteem of workers, responsibility and satisfying interpersonal relationships. So this model emphasizes that both concerns should be integrated to achieve the objectives of the organization. The managerial grid is built on two axes, one representing the people and the other representing the task. Now both the axes which we can see, the horizontal and the vertical axes, they are treated as a scale from 1 to 9, where 1 represents the least involvement and 9 represents the most involvement. So both the dimensions would be spread onto points from 1 to 9. Now Blake and Morton have identified 5 such coordinates that reflect various styles of leaders' behavior. You can see this in this diagram here, in this graph. There are 5 coordinates. The first one you can call it is 1,9. Another is 9,9, 5,5, 1,1 and 9,1. Now what does these coordinates represent? On the first hand we see, let us start up with 1,1, that is the least concern for result and least concern for people. Herein 1,1 represents lowest, it's known as the impoverished style of leadership, where the leader is least concerned about the results as well as people. So he is a sort of disoriented type of leader who is more serving his self-interest. Another coordinate we can discuss here is 9,1, which represents that it is high concern for results and low concern for people. So here we somewhat find out that the leader is more of task-oriented leader, and he is more focused on getting the work done rather than giving any form of focus on people issues. Another is 1,9, which is considered to be the country club style of leadership, wherein you can see the 1 coordinate is low and the 9 is high on concern for people. So low is the results and high is on people, so it's more of country club style of leadership, wherein the followers who are somewhat unskilled or they require more of leaders help and support in working would require this specific type of leadership style. Another is 9,9. So when we talk about 9,9, it is considered to be an idealistic style of leadership, wherein you would find high concern for people and high concern for results, wherein the leader would be more of delegating his authority to these people because they are quite skilled, they would be working independently. And so he is moreover ready to delegate his powers to these employees. So it's more of a people orientation as well as result oriented, it's collaboration of both of them. And then the last one is 5,5, that is in between, it is middle of the road style of leadership, where you can say it's the leader is not very high on results and is not very high on concern for people. So somewhat it comes in between, and this is basically for a mixed type of followers wherein they lack certain skills and are good at another skills but would require some form of supervision from the leader. So these are the five styles which have been identified under the managerial grid. Again, these have been explained on these slides where we call this 9.1, it's task oriented. So minimum work interference gives detailed instructions, supervise closely to make sure their directives are properly carried out, requires unquestioning obedience, no attention on development and communication with the employees. Next is country club. So maximum concern for people and minimum concern for production. It involves personal and meaningful relationships with people, friendly atmosphere and high morale, loosely structured work design. Impoverished, wherein we call it as 1.1 style, and manager makes minimum efforts to get the work done. He passes on the blame to others for the failures. So he is rarely taking any form of responsibility here. The 9.9, which is considered to be the team style, it has maximum concern of production and maximum concern of people. And this style is ultimate in managerial efficiency. These are thoroughly dedicated people. They are trustworthy, respectable. And this brings about the kind of team spirit that leads to high organization accomplishment. We have 5.5, that is middle road. So the people dimension in work is as important as production dimension. And this seeks a balance between the two styles. So meetings are held to listen to the suggestions of subordinates and to create a sense of belonging as well. Conclusion is, of this theory is the most desirable leadership behavior is 9.9, which says it is a team style and it is considered to be the most idealistic form of leadership behavior. You can see another diagram of this wherein the five styles are given here. Now moving ahead with the contingency theory, we would be covering Hussey and Plancard's situational leadership theory. Now this theory is basically which emphasizes upon the leader's style totally depends on the majority of followers. Now this considers leadership to be situational, and there are no specific traits or leadership styles which are certain and which can be utilized in all the situations. So this believes that the leadership style would vary with the situation. Whatever comes as situation, the leadership style can change. Now we can begin up with this theory. This theory basically believes that the leadership style differs with the difference in the majority of followers, wherein the majority can be described as the ability and willingness of the employees to perform. Now you can see here on the in this entire diagram, in this graph, there are four sets of maturities which are being given, ranging from M1 to M4, where M1 is the lowest maturity and M4 goes on to the highest. So M4 set of people or followers are mature. Now when we describe this, there are two dimensions in describing a maturity. The first dimension, what we talk of, is ability and willingness. So M1 is very low here, that means the followers are unable as well as unwilling to perform, and they would require a high task and high relationship type of leadership style, which is S1, and which is given as telling style. Because here they would require a lot of directions and a lot of instructions from the leader, as the followers do not have willingness as well as ability to perform. The second is M2. M2 describes that here the followers are willing but they are unable. So when they are unable, they require somewhat supervision of the leader, and they would require high task and low relationship. So it would be more of a selling style of leadership style. The third is M3, that is the maturity level of the followers is somewhat, they are able but they are unwilling. So it's like low on relationship and low task. A again, the leadership style would be more of participating, and the followers would like to participate here. Means that would be the most effective leadership style which a leader can follow here. He can ask the followers to work with him and to give suggestions in the decision making. So that might take out the best performance. And the last one is with high maturity of the followers, having both ability and willingness to work. It would be more of delegating style, that is S4, wherein the leader can actually rest all his powers or can transfer some of his powers to them because the maturity is very high. The people are quite independent to take their own decisions. And so it would be the delegating style of leadership. So this theory emphasizes this aspect, that it is basically the maturity of the followers which determines the leadership style, and it is not dependent upon any form of traits, or any style cannot be unique in all the situations. This is what it rests on. Another theory is, which is I can explain here, is Fiddler's contingency leadership style. This is the second what we call is a situational contingency scale. Now here Fiddler gave a scale wherein some of the leaders were asked to rate their least preferred co-worker, that is the worker with whom they would least prefer to work with. So based on this questionnaire, he identified two sets of leadership style. One who rated very low on the scale were considered to be task-oriented leadership, because whenever they worked with that person, they disliked it, and so they all rated the co-worker on a lower scale. On another side, you can see a higher side of it, wherein we can say that with these leaders who have rated on a higher scale are basically the high set or more of relationship-oriented leaders, because even though the co-workers were not preferred, but still they had rated them high because they believe that somewhat the relationship, good relationship, has to be maintained. So these two styles of leaderships were again identified by Fiddler, and then he said that with these two leadership styles, when the performance would be high. So you can see here the red line which you can see on the graph is the task-oriented leader, and the blue represents the relationship-oriented leader. Now in both the cases, you can identify here on the graph that where the performance is high. So again, Fiddler was able to actually identify the situational factors which are there which would lead to high performance. So the situational factors here are, three factors are there: leader-member relations, task structure, and leader position power. These are the three situations which are given here, which forms the factors in a situation, in a given situation, where a specific type of leadership style would result into high performance. So if you can see here on the graph, basically the column 1 and 2, wherein the leader member relation, task structure, and leader position power are good, high, and strong, weak. In this particular situation, if you look at the graph, the high performance is on task-oriented leadership. Now this task-oriented leadership goes down and becomes moderate. So moderate, where it is moderate in all those conditions, that is 3, 4, 5, you would find the relationship-oriented leadership is giving a high performance. And on the rest of the last three quadrants, that is 6, 7, 8, you would see that high performance is again, it's good when it is more of relationship, when it is more of task-oriented leadership. So this is how Fiddler's contingency model was basically successful in giving various factors which are there in a situation and which is going to yield high performance with a specific type of leadership style in a given situation. Thank you.